Now, moving on from that, let's move to primitive rest cell kind of tumors. Now, this entails conditions when you have mesenchymal things, epidermal, endodermis, all contribute, and depending on which cell line contributes, you can classify into different entities, and that would be between dermoid, teratoma, epidermoid, and accordingly. So let's move on. Of these, the primitive cell origin neoplasm, we are going to be briefly talking about epidermoid, dermoid, and teratoma. The first one being epidermoid, this is more frequently encountered than the other neoplasms. This is essentially because of an ectodermal implosion during neural tube closure in a congenital form. This can be congenital as well as acquired. So congenital would be during the neural tube closure, there is ectodermal inclusion which gets trapped inside the intracranial portion. This can easily be an acquired entity where related to prior surgery or trauma. Ectoderm can get included and causes an epidermoid formation. Histologically, it is identical to what we see as in cholesteatoma. Now, this can happen anywhere along the entire neural axis, wherever the neural tube closure happens. So it can be dorsal to the spinal cord, or it can be within the intracranial portion. It tends to be centrally located rather than peripheral, but it can happen anywhere in the brain. Most common location of this is generally at the CP angle. In fact, all dermoid, epidermoid, and teratoma, all of these congenital neoplasms tend to have their location centrally and among centrally, more frequently in the cellar, suprasellar, and CP angle region. Majority of the cases happen to be in this location. Now, in appearance, this can be frequently missed if it is small in size. If it is large in size, on CT, it is seen as a CSF density, and MRI on T2 and T1, it is seen as CSF intensity lesion. This has minimal mass effect, not much for the size of the epidermoid, but it appears as a lobulated kind of bubbly kind of appearing lesion along the border with sacculations along the border, which tends to insinuate along the margins of the brain, and it encases rather than displace, which would be seen, displacement would be seen in a clear cyst, but this is a lobulated kind of tumor which is growing along. It completely encases the subjacent vessels or nerves. The two classic sequences that are used to differentiate this from other entities are diffusion sequences and flare sequences. On the flare, it has a kind of a dirty appearance. It is called as the dirty CSF sign. On T1 and T2, it can be clearly missed as a complete CSF intensity, where it will be difficult to differentiate between an arachnoid cyst or say neurocysticercosis when it is small. But on flare, it will have a dirty CSF sign. But on the hallmark of this as being a restricted diffusion, where it is like a light bulb which stands out within the brain parenchyma. So it can be clearly differentiated from all other entities like arachnoid cyst or neurocysticercosis or any other cause of a cyst existing along the intracranial portion. So the study of choice to diagnose an epidermoid is diffusion sequence. And even on post-resection, when the neoplasm has been decompressed or excised, the main sequence that you use to look for any recurrent or residual epidermoid would be a diffusion sequence. And moving on from an epidermoid tumor, let's go on to the second form, which is the dermoid tumor. Now, both epidermoid and dermoid are strictly ectodermal in nature. The difference between the two is epidermoid is entirely from squamous cell epithelium, whereas the dermoid has both squamous cell epithelium as well as dermal appendages, which include sebaceous and sweat glands and hair within it, producing sebum, which gives it the characteristic appearance. Now, there is a very common misconception that there is fat inside dermoids. Now, adipose tissue is a mesodermal component. It is not an ectodermal, whereas dermoid, strictly speaking, a dermoid has ectodermal origin. So the thing that is present inside the sebum would be including cholesterol, hair cells, sebaceous glands, keratin, squamous epithelium, and protein byproducts would be giving the hyper intense T1 signal intensity. And that is what we see on classically the imaging. On CT, it is classically a low attenuation lesion with fluid level related to debris, can potentially have calcification, which can be chunky calcification, which can be a tooth-like calcification, which can be a central calcification, or it can be a circumferential peripheral calcification. If we see a tooth inside the lesion, alveolar innervation lesion with fluid fred level, that is the hallmark. Unless proven otherwise, it is going to be a dermoid cyst. Now, CT is a low attenuation, kind of a fat density lesion, lobulated mass with calcification, which can be rim or chunky calcification, and MRI is much more variable. Can be predominantly it is a hyperintense lesion on T1 with fluid fred level because of cholesterol present, whereas on T2 it is very variable. It can be hyper intense to hypo intense in nature. There is a fluid level present. The important thing to note about it is that this is a lesion that grows because there is constant secretion from the sebaceous glands and the sweat glands. There is constant slow increase in size, and because of that there is a progressive increase in mass effect, and it can potentially rupture. And when it does rupture, there is these hyperintense droplets which are seen diffusely within the CSF spaces. This being lighter than a CSF, it tends to float superiorly rather than being in a dependent portion. So if we'll, as we see over here in the lateral ventricles, the T1 hyperintensity is floating in the frontal horn, and in the second case it is dispersed throughout. But if we look at it, majority of it will eventually, when the patient is supine, will float up anteriorly. This causes severe chemical meningitis and potentially, if not almost always, fatal because of the severe chemical meningitis. So on CT, it is low to fat attenuation with calcification associated with the tooth and hair cells within it. And on MR, it is a very variable intensity, but there are components of susceptibility or calcification and T1 hyperintensity. And when it ruptures, this same T1 hyperintensity from cholesterol floats up superiorly along the non-dependent portion. Moving on to the next form of primitive or congenital cell line tumor, we would be talking about teratoma. Now, as we talked about in dermoid and epidermoid, which is epidermal in location or in origin, teratoma, on the other hand, contains two or three layers of the dermal elements. It may, it has to at least contain two layers, and maybe it may contain all three layers of the dermal elements. This is a more aggressive form of neoplasm as opposed to dermoid and epidermoid. It has solid and a cystic component, both on CT and MRI. The appearance can be described in a very similar fashion. So you will see a solid cystic component. It will have calcification, not the kind of calcification like the chunky prominent calcification as we saw in dermoid, but there will be associated calcifications with this. It will be a solid tumor, it will be a cystic tumor component with it. As we talked about in dermoid and epidermoid, these tend to be centrally located, the frequent locations being the pineal region, the suprasellar region, the CP angle region. These would be the typical locations. We see a solid cystic mass in this area with calcifications, we should think of teratoma. As opposed to the first two tumors, the solid component in a teratoma will show enhancement. This is a lesion which is lipid rich, so this will actually truly have fat cells within it because it is arising from at least two layers, fat being mesenchymal in origin. So this is an example on a CT where we see a solid slash cystic mass lesion with areas of calcification situated in the pineal gland area, and it is causing obstructive hydrocephalus probably because of compression on the aqueduct of Sylvius. So this is, again, this is something that we have to talk about, the hydrocephalus. This is what can decompensate the patient very quickly. So this is a patient who should not go home. It is a patient who we have to call the clinician and tell them whether he should be sent to the ER or should be sent to the clinic, because this patient can decompensate quickly and die. So this on MR imaging is again the same description, where it is a solid cystic component. The T1 hyperintensity here is actually truly fat because the mesenchyme is lining is in this neoplasm. Now this is again situated along the CSF outflow path, so it is again causing hydrocephalus. On contrast administration, this would have associated enhancement in the solid component. The fallout of signal which we are seeing on the T1 sequences because of the calcification present within this lesion. So as opposed to dermoid, there will be no fluid fluid level in this thing. Dermoid, the classic finding is a fluid fluid level. Here it is completely absent. It is a purely solid and a cystic lesion with enhancement and with calcification. So that is how we would see teratoma. Now this is a relatively aggressive tumor. It is something that can be associated with drop metastasis. So one of this shows up on your MR scanner. It is our obligation to make sure that we image the entire neural axis to look for any drop metastasis or an associated leptomeningeal enhancement, as opposed to what would not be necessary in the case of epidermoid or dermoid lesions. Moving on to the final type of primitive cell line tumor, we would be talking about germinoma. Now, germinoma is very similar to other tumors like lymphoma or primitive neuroectodermal tumor, basically because of histology. This is a round blue cell tumor, so it will be a high nucleus cytoplasmic ratio, densely packed cells. So this would be in appearance very, very similar to, in imaging characteristics, very, very similar to what we would see in a primitive neuroectoderm tumor or lymphoma, where we will see a dense lesion on CT, ISO2, hyperintense mass on T1 and T2 sequence, which shows intense enhancement. This tumor is also called as a dysgerminoma or an extragonadal seminoma, and like all the other primitive cell line tumors, this is also something that tends to be in the midline. Predominantly, it happens in mid-pediatric patients. So the typical locations are in the pineal gland region or the third ventricular, inferior third ventricular region or suprasellar region. Classic being within the pineal gland region. So this would be like a lobulated soft tissue mass which is sitting in the pineal gland region. Typically, it entirely engulfs the pineal gland. And because of that, there might be a central chunky calcification. Now, that central chunky calcification is what would differentiate that it is engulfing the pineal gland rather than inherently pineal gland neoplasm, where the calcification in those tumors like pineocytoma or pineoblastoma, it would be a burst calcification, as opposed to a germinoma where it will be a central calcification. So on imaging, on CT, it is a hyperdense lesion. On MR, it is a high ISO2 hyperintense, both on T1 and T2 sequences. There may be small areas of hemorrhage, but not a clear large hematoma. It tends to engulf the surrounding structures as well as cause mass effect. And when it is situated in the region of pineal gland, there might be a chunky calcification, which is actually the calcification of the pineal gland. When you give contrast to this neoplasm, like what we see in lymphoma and PNETs, there will be an intense associated enhancement. So this is a non-contrast CT examination. It is a hyperdense mass, lobulated mass lesion. This one is sitting in the suprasellar region or the inferior third ventricle region. Moving on to the MR, this is an intensely enhancing mass lesion, two separate tumors. The first and the third sequences are in the region of the suprasellar third ventricular area. The second slide is of a neoplasm sitting in the pineal gland region. Now, this is again a neoplasm which is in the CSF region. So this is a lobulated soft tissue debris kind of neoplasm sitting. So as we talked about in choroid plexus papillary carcinoma, as we talked about in medulloblastoma, this is another tumor that we have to image the entire neural axis, because this is something that would be causing drop metastasis. Also, it would cause hydrocephalus, both because of cellular debris as well as because of obstruction, direct obstruction. So tumor sitting in the region of pineal gland would directly push on the quadrigeminal plate and cause obstructive hydrocephalus due to compression of the aqueduct of Sylvius. So lesion which is intensely enhancing, sitting in these classical locations with a restricted diffusion, is, unless proven otherwise, a germinoma, and we have to look for on restricted diffusion, as well as we have to do the entire neural axis imaging to look for potential drop metastasis. So those are pretty much cover a neoplasm arising from primitive cells. Now, there are a whole bunch of other neoplasms, but those three or four entities constitute 99% of the neoplasm arising from primitive cell lines and are typically found in the central portion of the brain along the midline, although can happen anywhere, but classically they are present along the central line. Let's talk about neoplasms that arise from arachnoid cell lines. So the classic one, or the most common one, would be the arachnoid cyst. Now, this is not a true neoplasm. This is an entirely benign entity. This can be both congenital in nature, or it can be acquired related to a tear in an arachnoid lining. So what happens is there's a confined arachnoid lined CSF cyst collection. There is no communication with the ventricles. This is completely independent. Most common typical location is within the CP angles or within the middle cranial fossa, and it follows CSF intensity on all sequences. So that is what would be differentiating this entity from which we talked about previously, that is the epidermoid cyst. So the two main things that we talked about in cases of epidermoid are the dirty CSF sign on flare sequences, which would not be present over here, but it would be even on flare sequences, entirely clear dark following CSF intensity. And the restricted diffusion, which we talked in epidermoid, where there is intense restricted diffusion, here this is not associated with any restricted diffusion. It will be dark on diffusion sequences with CSF intensity on all sequences. And what we might potentially see is there might be a pulsation artifact related to the phase region, as well as, since this is a long standing thing, there's constant pulsations on the subjacent bone, so there'll be associated bone scalloping, there'll be associated mild mass effect on the brain parenchyma related to this being a cyst staying in a confined calvarium. And one of the important things that we have to understand is this still communicates with the CSF. So if you inject dye like in a myelogram, immediately the CSF will entirely fill up with contrast, whereas this would not be filling up with contrast immediately, but you get a delayed examination because of its communication. Eventually this will also fill up with contrast, and you will see that this is actually a cyst which communicates with the CSF spaces, confirming this is an arachnoid cyst. So we saw that that was an arachnoid cyst on a CT examination. This would be an arachnoid cyst on MR examination. So a huge CSF intensity on all sequences within the right convexity. This is the typical location within a second slice, where it is in the situated within the middle cranial fossa. And the same one, to differentiate from an epidermoid, we did a diffusion sequence where there is absolutely no restricted diffusion, which if this was an epidermoid would be associated with light bulb restricted diffusion. So this causes pushing of the entire brain parenchyma, scalloping of the bone, buckling of the grave-white distinction. These are all the things that you use to describe an arachnoid cyst. Again, it is CSF intensity in all sequences. If it is big enough, it causes mass effect. There is thinning of the bone because of constant CSF pulsations. That is the most common thing that we see. In fact, probably about like 99% of the lesion that we see in relation to the arachnoid cells. And it is a very, very common tumor. Most of the time it's incidental. Most of the time you don't have to do anything with it, unless the patient is presenting with severe headache. And this is what we are seeing. Then the surgeon goes in, causes, creates a fenestration, or puts in a drainage catheter in it, like a shunt catheter in it, and decompresses it. So if it is causing mass effect, if it is causing herniation, if it is causing any displacement of brain parenchyma, or if it is associated with headaches, then those are the possible treatment, where you create a fenestration and you or you can put in a shunt catheter. And then on subsequent examination, the patient will probably come back to you for follow-up evaluation to look whether it is being effective or not.